हेलो डियर फ्रेंड्स, हेलो डियर स्टूडेंट, आई एम लक्ष्मीकांत कापगते एंड वेलकम बैक टू माय यूट्यूब चैनल। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट और वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न अनदर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पोएम ऑफ अवर सिलेबस, दैट इज एन आयरिश एयरमैन फोर्सेस हिज डेथ, कंपोज बाय अ वेरी फेमस पोएट ऑफ आयरिश वर्ल्ड और द आयरिश लिटरेचर, दैट इज विलियम बटलर ईट्स। विलियम बटलर ईट्स was an Irish poet, he was a dramatist, prose writer, and one of the most or the foremost figure of the 20th century literature. He was a pillar of the Irish literary establishment, and he played a very vital role in the formation or in the foundation of Abbey Theatre or the Irish or the National Theatre of Ireland. So let's begin with the introduction of the poet. William Butler Yeats was born in Dublin, that is the capital of Ireland, on June 13, 1865, and died in France because his family moved to France in London, and he was in France for some time. So he was died on January 28, 1939. 39, it was the year of the beginning when the Second World War was started. He was deeply involved with the politics of Ireland, and that is why he focused on the Celtic revival, means the Irish revival or the Irish literature. So that movement was against the cultural influences of the British rules or the British cultures in Ireland during the Victorian period. And they sought to promote the spirit of Irish heritage or the national native heritage of his country. The most important, honor that was awarded in to W. B. Yeats, that is the Nobel Prize for his literature. It was given to W. B. Yeats in 1923 for his always inspired poetry, and which is highly artistic form that gives expression to the spirit of a whole nation. So this man, W. B. Yeats, played a very important role in various groups or the literary world. He formed Rhymers Club, or he formed Abbey Theatre of Ireland, right? He also translated the Upanishads. He had written the preface to Gitanjali, a very famous work by Rabindranath Tagore. There are some important things that we are going to start enjoying. So he started his literary career as a romantic poet, and gradually he evolved into a modernist poet. He had presented the spirit of his age in his writing, in his verses, in his poetries, along with he had used or he borrowed various mythologies or the symbolism, colloquial language, and the literary allusion as a device to express his literary or his anxiety to modernity about the modern man. He wrote this poem during the First World War. Means he published this poem in 1919. Okay, so during that period, the World War I was going on or ended. So during that period, many people were suffered from frustration, boredom, anxiety, and loneliness. And that is why he had used different type of landscape to symbolize the spiritual and the psychological state of modern man. Okay, so he was closely associated, means he was a man who used various symbols or the symbolistic symbolism in his poetry. So as a symbolism poet, a symbolist poet, he had used allusion or the allusive imagery or the symbolic structure throughout his career. Okay, so as I already said, that he was the member, or he was the pillar in the establishment, or the, he was the main pioneer of Abbey Theatre, who helped to found in the foundation of Abbey Theatre. And now this Abbey Theatre is known as the National Theatre of Ireland. So this Abbey Theatre was founded in 1899 with the help of Isabella Augusta, Lady Gregory, and others. So they devoted this theatre to promote or to foster the Irish, you can say, Irish poetic drama. Okay, so let's come to the poem. So the title of the poem is An Irish Airman Foresees His Death. So now, my dear student, you can understand the title itself. An Irish airman. Airman means a pilot. A man who is going to fight in the World War I. He is going to enjoy the fighting in the World War I. Okay. So he says, an Irish airman foresees his death. It means that he is talking about his death. He assumed that he will die in future in the World War I while fighting with his enemy. So that is why that is the expression, or that is the, you can say, the dramatic monologue, or it is a poem that talks about the expression or the opinion or the feeling of an Irish airman about his death, about his future, about his doomsday. So let's begin. So before going into the details, I must tell you that when you try to understand this poem, you must find out these elements. For example, you know, an Irish airman foresees his death. It means that I told you that he is going to fight in the war. So that is why we can bring this poem into the category of war poem. There is the adventure of Irish pilot or the Irish pilot. He's adventurous, he's fighting, his, you know, bombarding and all these things that happens in this poem or in the war. That is why heroic activity we can find. There is a sense of nationalism, means the patriotic feeling, his love for his motherland, his love for nationalism that we understand in this poem. Basically, this is an elegy. Many critics says that this is an elegy written on by William Butler Yeats on the death of Robert Gregory. Robert Gregory was a son of Lady Gregory, and Lady Gregory was a close associate, means she was a friend of W.B. Yeats. And that is why he was very much hurted. He was very much, you know, he became very nervous when he heard the news of his friend's son's death, Robert Gregory. Okay. So there is a sense of helplessness. Means the pilot is expressing his sense of helplessness. And I told you as this is a dramatic monologue. The speaker of this poem is Irish pilot, and he is telling us a story. He is expressing, or he's just writing his own story in the form of dramatic monologue. Okay. And this whole setting of the poem is set in World War I, and the major concept or the big concept that we find in this poem is that appears in the title itself, the death of Irish airman. Okay. So Irish pilot. Let's begin the text. So let me read the poem. I know that I shall meet my fate somewhere among the clouds above. Those that I fight, I do not hate. Those that I guard, do not love. My country's is Kiltartan's cross. My countrymen Kiltartan's poor. No likely end could bring them loss or leave them happier than before. Nor law nor duty bade me fight, nor public men nor cheering crowds. A lonely impulse of delight drove this tumult in this clouds. I balance all, he says, I balance all, brought all to mind. The years to come seem a waste of breath, the years behind, in balance with this life, this death. Okay, so this is the text that I read just now. Let me explain one by one. So he says, so my dear student, the poem An Irish Airman Foresees His Death began with the very first first person pronoun. And this first person pronoun is I. And I refers to Robert Gregory, an Irish or the Irish pilot, Irish airman. So he writes like this, I know that I shall meet my fate. He is talking about the real situation. He knows the truth. He knows the reality. And he says, ki, I know what will happen in the war. What will happen? He will meet to his death. What is the meaning of fate? Fate doesn't mean, you know, the simple meaning you cannot consider here. The poetic language tells us that the meaning of fate is death. It means that the speaker in this poem is saying that he will die while flying his airplane in the World War I. Okay. And where he will die? He says, the next line you can understand, I shall meet my fate somewhere among the cloud above. Somewhere. He is not sure about the place and the time of his death. But he's sure that okay, I will die. I may die in the clouds above. In the sky, my doomsday will be there. Okay. And he continues and says, okay, those that I fight, I do not hit. Now see, he is just very far from that biased attitude. There is no pressure on his mind, right? He also says that there is no any prejudice in his mind. There is no any, you know, you can say the concept or any hate or any hatred, any, you know, anger in his mind. So that is why he says, just wait. Okay. Come to the. Just wait. Okay. Now come to the point. So those that I do not fight means he's going to enjoy the fight. He's going to, you know, throw bomb or bombarding on his enemy. Okay, so those that I fight means he is not or he there is no any hateful ideas or the biased ideas or the biased prejudiced attitude in his mind against his enemies, against his foes. So those means his enemy, and hate means hatred. Okay, so those that I fight, I do not hate. He also says, those that I guard, I do not love. What is the meaning of guard? Guard means he is fighting for his country. He is fighting from the side of his motherland. So he says, I do not love them. Okay? He do not hate to his enemy. He do not love to his motherland. Okay? Now come to the next line again. So my country is Kiltartan's cross. Now he's talking about his motherland, his birthplace. He says, my country, my Ireland, my Irish world or the Irish land, about that he's talking about in this line, my country is Kiltartan Cross. Kiltartan Cross, that refers to the region of the country or the county Galway on the southwest coast of Ireland, and specifically this Kiltartan cross is a medieval Catholic church. So this cross referred to church. Okay. So my country is Kiltartan cross. My countrymen Kiltartan's poor. Kiltartan's poor means the poor people of the Kiltartan, means the county's Galway. Okay. So people, those who lived in that place, he says, my countrymen, my people, my poor people, my simple and ordinary people from my land, he says. Now see, in this line, means the first, means the third and the fourth line, the fifth and the sixth line, you can see there is a repetition of the same words. So the third line begins with the those I that fight. Okay, those that I, my country is, my countrymen, right? So there is a repetition of the same words or the same phrase, and he begin the next line here, right? So he says, my countrymen, means there is no loss. He says, no likely end could bring them loss. Okay? Due to this war, because of this fighting, because of this, you know, devotion in the war, no loss or no any, you know, you can say the benefit they received, there is no any possibility. So no likely end could bring them loss. So whatever they have lost in their life, whatever or the things that they have lost in their life, there is not a single chance to recover all these things or this loss, he says, or leave them happier than before, or this war cannot make them happier, bring happiness in their life than before, he says, right? So these eight lines is you know are describing the Irish world, Irish people, or the Irish mindset, or Irish countrymen, Irish country, you can say, right? And he presented his view about his about this World War One, about his involvement in the world, right? In this war, he says. Now you will find that when you go and understand this poem, you will find that the first two lines, right? In the first two lines, the speaker introduced the idea of death. Okay. And we miss the audience is sure that he will die among the cloud above, right? So this phrase introduced the idea of air in relation to the death in this poem, right? And the interesting thing is that an air is often associated with life and breathe here, right? And line number third and fourth is talking about the speaker feels. Miss, in these two lines, we can understand that here the speaker, Irish airman, feels separated from his role in this war. Miss, he is detached from this involvement or in this war, he says. So it seems as though he feels nothing, since he neither hates nor love to anyone, to his enemy, to his countrymen too. Okay, so at this point we can notice that the tone, right, the tone of the speaker or the poem of indifference in the speaker's language, right? So now come to the fifth and sixth language. So in fifth and sixth language, he says, "Ki my countryman is killed at any cross." In line number five and six, he identifies his place of birth and his, you can say, his attachment to his birthplace, right? So we can understand the alliteration, right? The figure of speech alliteration in this poem, the country and the cross, the countryman and the Kiltartan's poor. So there is a repetition of the alphabets or the sounds. Okay, so we will talk about later. Okay, now come to the seventh and eighth line. Number seven, no likely end could bring them loss or leave them happier than before. These two lines, you can see, that focuses or that talks about the outcome of the war or the result of the war, right? What will happen? The outcome of the war will have little effect on the poor lives of the Kiltartan cross. And the speaker seems to have an extremely rational view of the world or about the world in this line, right? So my dear student, I hope you understood these eight lines. So let's come to the next eight lines. So he says, "Nor law nor duty bade me fight, nor public men nor cheering crowd, a lonely impulse of delight drove this tumult in this cloud," right? Now come to these four lines. So in this quatrain, or in these four lines, the speaker states that the usual attraction of war did not entice him, and that he chose to become a soldier because of a lonely impulse of delight. And this is for the first time, or the first irrational tone or the note of the speaker, right? And the word tumult, you can see this meaning of this word. Tumult means chaos. Tumult means confusion. So the speaker is referring specifically to the dogfights between the enemy's fighter plane in the sky up above. In the sky, he says. So he is not motivated because of the patriotism, because of the nationalism, or no any law is forcing him. It is not a part of his duty. It is not said by some public men or the public elected by the Irish public or the representative of the Ireland, right? So he's just involved, as his wish is there. He is involved in that war, And he cleared or he clarifies that no one is forcing me to go and fight in this war. Okay. So this is a sharp contrast to the extremely rational view of the speaker earlier in this poem. Okay. And we can find that in this particular poem, he says, a lonely impulse of delight. Actually, this line has been taken by one of the main, you know, director of European world, and he broadcasted the series of episodes, and he has given this title, this line as a title to his episodes. Okay, so grow this tumult. Tumult, I told you, tumult means chaos. And he also says, grow this tumult in these clouds. And now come to the next four lines. In the next four lines, he's very much, you know, very much sure about his death. And he says, like a rational thinking, or he's very rational in his thinking. And he says, or he stated that, I balanced all. Means what balanced? Balanced of death and life, life and death. Okay. Like in Rhyme of Ancient Mariner, the mariner stated that my situation is like, you know, life in death and death in life. So he balanced these two things in this case, right? In this war. So I balanced all, brought all to mind. He has stored these idea or the balanced situation in his minds, and the years to come seem waste of breath, right? Now, what is the meaning of, what is the meaning of this line? I balanced all, brought all to mind. The years to come seem waste of breath, a waste of breath, the years behind, in balanced with this life, this death. Okay. So these four lines balance the rational and the irrational aspect in this poem. And the speaker reveals that the rational world, he comes from, offers rational or the irrational answer to the problem, like war, right? And speaker also balances life and death by comparing them both to a waste of breath, right? This waste of breath is a phrase that is repeated in these two lines, waste of breath and waste of breath, the years behind. So this brings back the idea of an year as a life, right? Waste of breath means waste of life. Waste of breath, breath means life. Okay. He says it is labeled as a waste. Okay. By equating life and death, the speaker enables himself, and he accepted the death, his death, you can say. So this is the brief explanation about this poem. It means that he accepted. It is a natural process, likewise, he says, and no one is forcing me, nor law, nor duty, bade me fight. Bade means encouraged, forced me, inspired me to go and fight with my enemy, nor public men, means the representative or the democratic leader of my world, have not forced me to go and involve in this war, or not the cheering crowds, or the sense of patriotism has not forced me to go in this war. So he declares that it is a sense of, or it is a lonely impulse of delight. Delight means happiness. It is a lonely impulse of delight that drove to this tumult in these clouds, right? And he says, I balanced all, brought all to this mind, the years to come seem to waste of breath, right? So in this particularly, he is talking about the theme of patriotism, right? It is very clear that the pilot, an Irish airman, who is serving for the Britons or the British Royal Air Force, okay, there is a grief, or there is a sense of expression or sense of patriotism that we reveal in this poem. Okay, then we can understand that the fate of Irish airman is described in this poem, or in this in this particular verse. There is a theme of obedience also. In this poem, the obedience, he is trying to follow the order of his mind, a lonely impulse of delight. He wants to enjoy the fight in his life, and that is why he is going to enjoy that kind of act, that kind of adventure in his first fight, you can say. Now come to the very important thing about this poem. Let us talk about the form of the poem. As we have seen, this poem has 16 lines, and these 16 lines are divided into 4 quatrain. Quatrain means the 4-line stanza, and each of which follows the same basic rhyme scheme, that is AB, AB. Means the rhyming scheme in this poem, you can see AB, AB, okay, that is 4 grouped that we can find, that is AB, AB, CD, CD, EF, EF, G, G, GH, GH, sorry. So this is, there is a repetition of the basic rhyme scheme that is utilizing different rhyme. Okay. So this poem is composed of 4 quatrain in a continuous 16 line stanza. And each quatrain has an ABAB rhyme scheme. And the poem uses iambic tetrameter, that is a form of a meter. And he also employs different poetic or the rhetorical devices. We will see one by one. Let us see and understand the rhetorical devices. The first one is metaphor. So he, in the very opening line, he says, I shall meet my fate. So there is a comparison between two objects. I shall meet my fate. Fate is death. So fate is, you know, compared to his death, to his doomsday. Then in line number 12, we can find this tumult, row this tumult in these clouds. Okay. So in this poem, we can find that there are some examples that talks about the metaphorical example. And in line number 14 and miss the second line, 14 and 15 line of this poem that talks about the years to come seems waste of breath, waste of life. Okay. A waste of breath, the years behind. This is again an example of metaphor. Again, we can find the repetition of the line in this poem. Those that I fight, I do not hate. Those that I guard, I do not love. There is a repetition of the same line in line number 3 and line number 4. Again, we can find the assonance, another important rhetorical device or the figure of speech. So almost all the poems you can see the assonance in all the poem. For example, that kind of A is a vowel, and that sound is appeared in fate, hate, cross, loss in line number 1st and 3rd and 5th and 7th respectively. Okay. Then come to the meter. So as I told you, this poem is written in iambic tetrameter. What is meaning of tetrameter? Means tetrameter is a combination or is a mixture of 4 feet of iamb. Okay, so that is known as iambic tetrameter. So in this iambic tetrameter, iamb is, one is unstressed and the second one is, or unstressed followed by stress. So here also we can find, I know, sorry, I have done something wrong in this line. It should not, like that is highlighted here. Okay. I know that I shall meet my fate. So da-dum, 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 right? The first lining of the line that we can talk about the of the poem. I know that I shall meet my fate. Now, what is the meaning of I am? You can find on the screen that I am sounds like a heartbeat. Okay. So it is called a tetrameter because there are 4 feet of I ams. Then come to the speaker. So the speaker is an Irish fighter pilot in a World War I. And the poem is based on the life and death of a real pilot, Major Robert Gregory, who was a son of Yeats's friend, Lady Gregory, who flew or who was going for the first time in the World War I and who flew with the British Royal Air Force and died during the World War I. Okay. So this Gregory, Robert Gregory was a son of Lady Gregory. And this poem was written as an elegy for him, which is why this presentation or this, you know, guide uses masculine pronoun to refer to the speaker. Okay. So I hope, my dear student, you have understood the poem or this important or interesting poem that is composed by W.B. Yeats. Actually, this poem has been taken from the collection of his publication of his anthology, that is The Wild and the Coolie, that was published in 1919. Okay. And another important thing that I missed here, he wrote three poems on the death of Robert Gregory, Major Robert Gregory. One is published in The Wild and the Coolie, and other two poems were published in another work, right? So another two poems were the, let me tell you that he wrote three poems. One is In the Memory of Major Robert Gregory, and another one was The Shepherd and the Goatyard. So these two poems or three poems were written on the death of Major Robert Gregory. So I hope, my dear student, you understood the explanation. If you have any question, you can email me, you can contact me. I will try to solve the issues. Okay. So thanks for watching. And if you are new on my channel, you can subscribe my channel so that you can get the latest notification of the uploaded video. Thank you.